Thank you so much for this talk. In terms of PAs for consultants, because that's with job planning, that's obviously the conversation that will come up. How much does that amount to?
Well, as in my AHC commitment, out of my
triaging commitment.
Right. It's we have to go to one morning every 7 weeks.
Okay.
Because there's a group of about seven of us that provide services within the one building. Now, we are not all ADHD clinicians. Some of those will be neurodevelopmental. Mm-hmm. So there's currently three ADHD clinicians, two and a half, within the building. So they will. The commitment is you cancel one clinic every 7 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
But the knock-on effect for that is so, so much more than that.
Just to dig a bit deeper into that, how do you or how do you manage that in the face of increasing demand? Because if I went to my managers and said, listen, this sounds a great idea, look at these graphs, I've still got a backlog of patients that's ever increasing to be seen, that I'll take away clinical time to be seen and in to do triage. So how do you manage the transitionary period?
The managers actually bought into this very, very early on, and our nurse manager, who's quite senior in the hierarchy, was one of the drivers of this, because she is very much systems and process orientated, and she could see the rank inefficiency in kids being all over the place in clinics across three different sites, seeing different people, and often seeing different people for the same problem. So she was saying, we are giving out far, far too many appointments for the same thing. So with that clinical pathway, which is quite akin to what you were talking about, and the streamlined pathway, we were able then very early on to demonstrate a much greater efficiency. And therefore, the management bought into this really, really easily then, because they would even say your throughput is much more. Yes, in the sense that we had raised these issues, which management knew about, but what we were able to do then was to back up what we were saying with data, and equally then compare pre and post, and be able to say, yes, we were right about this, but equally, you have bought into this and changed something alongside us, and therefore we're both right. And that's political language, and politics in Northern Ireland just go hand in hand. We have a separate coordinator for the autism pathway, but the children can flip-flop between the two internally without having to come out of one pathway and go and sit on the big waiting list for the other one. So there's an internal referral pathway between the autism pathway and the ADHD pathway. And there's a huge substantial overlap, and I think to have them as sort of parallel circuits would be utterly wrong. So they're very much integrated that way.
Is this mine? It's a question to both you and Susan about transitions to adult services. What challenges are you facing in your areas? I'm just asking, it's a selfish question.
The behavioural nurse that we were able to employ would be behavioural, and that would be ADHD or ASD. So on that panel is a paediatrician, a child and adolescent psychiatrist, social worker, a referrals coordinator who puts all of this together and will then allot the child to the right pathway once we've decided as a group where the child needs to go. We've got allied healthcare professionals that will be speech and language, OT and physiotherapy. We also have the autism coordinator, and also we have a family support hub, which is an amalgamation of about 13 or 14 voluntary agencies that provide services to children within our trust. So the service challenge that we were facing was, we have got 1.6 consultants and now one associate specialist, one who's now retired. We couldn't even have enough review slots to see the patients we had. So we're not compliant with NICE guidelines. Now this is playing managerial speak here. That's a big statement to say to your managers and take it up to the chief executive. we can't meet NICE guidelines on this. So if something adverse happens and there's a case management review, well, that looks very, very bad. So that is a very powerful thing that we were able to pull out of this data. We're currently seeing our new patients within 9 weeks, and there's about 30 to 40 new referrals of ADHD into our service per week. So we've got the triage single point of entry here, which is the triage committee. We do insist on information coming in, so I just don't want to see a child say, ADHD, please assess. There's a body of information comes in with each child now, and as Susan alluded to earlier, there's a big amount of work goes into all this before the kid even comes in through the door. We use questionnaires routinely. I don't really mind what questionnaires people use as long as they use them and use them consistently. We moved away from using Connors because we felt they were too expensive. We do use SDQ for the initial appointment for the sole reason that the parents do not feel that they are running their child into the ground. Connors, negative, ADHDRS, all really negative. SDQ, you're bringing out some of the really positive attributes that these children have. Not all of them, but some of them. But I don't really find that using SDQ consistently for a clinical review gives me enough information. I would use ADHDRS consistently on a review basis to assess efficacy. So we then decide, right, if there's enough information, they can come forward and be seen by one of the paediatricians, and if there's enough information, we can make the diagnosis. And I would say that we're in the same territory as you. We're in the 90s for the diagnostics, because an awful lot of the referrals that we think don't have enough information or are inappropriate are weeded out beforehand, so don't actually get this far. We were the first trust in Ireland to put in QB test, and I think it's a very vital part of what we do, as it gives very objective evidence. One of the cases that I find it's very, very useful in is the pushy parent who thinks that their little Emily is not clever enough, therefore there must be something wrong with her. And they get an assessment and say, no, and they said, well, we don't believe that. And I said, well, she's had a QB test, which is absolutely perfect. There's no ADHD present here, and they still want to argue. And I said, well, I'm quite happy if you want to sit and argue with the laptop. Just, I'm not going to be in the room while you do that. I have other things to be doing. So we find it very useful for the negatives, but equally we find it as a very useful discriminator of subtle inattention in particularly girls. So that's why we were asked a parliamentary question about why our diagnostic rate was so high, and that was one of the things that we alluded to, was we are able to make a call, particularly in those borderlines, using objective evidence. So we then had a look at, well, what can we do with the children that we have, what interventions are available to them. So they can be seen just by a paediatrician. They can be seen by step two, which is our behavioural intervention run by behaviourally trained nurses and also ADHD trained nurses. We've got close links with psychology and also CAMHS, to the point where we've actually got joint diagnostic clinics with psychology and CAMHS. And find that a very, very useful way, particularly for the very complex patients, to have that body of opinion available at the same time, and also that crucial level of discussion that you can have face to face, because there's shared clinical time, rather than letters we've been waiting to be typed up, to be batted back and forward. This we have found to be very, very useful. Again, utterly uncommissioned, but we've identified the need, and therefore we're currently plugging that gap. Now this model that we have is based on the fact that we have a face-to-face interview with a school report and using a rating scale is a very powerful way of accurately diagnosing ADHD. It gives you a greater safety net. You don't miss important pieces of information. It lessens your risk of making a misdiagnosis. It improves patient outcome, and it's also a very time efficient way, and Susan's very accurately demonstrated that with the number of appointments needed to get the diagnosis. Now, whenever I was speaking earlier, I was saying about the data I had collected being somewhat unique. I decided to start looking at this from a clinical time perspective. This is the most important resource that you as clinicians have, because I'm sure you would all love to clone yourselves in order to be able to manage the workload that you currently have. Note I didn't say do more work, just manage the amount that you're currently doing. So I allied this to an intervention that was available in from about March 2013, which was long-acting dexamphetamine. And what I looked at was how long over a 3-month period, how much clinical resource has been taken up, and that's in the form of face-to-face appointments, emails or telephone calls, and how much each patient consumed in a 3-month period pre and post-intervention. Now, if you look at that first bar, that is patients with ADHD who are either refractory to treatment or have a significant comorbidity, typically autism. They are taking up in a 3-month period just shy of 6 hours of my clinical time. High, high consumption of clinical resource. And the reason for that is there's a problem. They are not getting an adequate outcome. That is phone calls from parents, phone calls from schools, phone calls from educational psychology. And equally, if we look at over on the far right-hand side as you look at it, these are a group of children who aren't getting an outcome on methylphenidate. So they are consuming a much less resource, but equally they're not getting an outcome either. So all these children are getting a poor outcome on their initial treatment. So what I was looking at then was the reduction in the amount of time. So it made a massive difference to the children who were refractory or had comorbid autism. If they were able to get an outcome, they're not phoning you. They're not bothering your secretary. They're not bunging up your email, your inbox in your email to say things aren't going well. Now there's a slight blip with two of the groups because there was an increased intervention in order to optimise their treatment on Elvance. So, but what I don't want to make this about anything pharmaceutical. It was just a novel way of looking at something that really the management hadn't taken into account, was that if these children are adequately managed and given a good outcome with behavioural intervention, behavioural therapy and optimisation of their medication, they will take much less of your service. They need less review appointments, there will be less crises. And what this has enabled me to do then is to take this to the next step. I was able to put this together in a form of cost saving. And that's a nice word to be using if you're approaching commissioners. The idea I have here is cost saving. So what has come out of it? We have now 2 behavioural nurse specialists extra as to what we had, one of whom is an independent prescriber, and the second one is doing the course. We've established a tier of primary mental health workers, and that has been incredibly useful for looking at the group who are under the age of 6 and whom medication is not indicated as first line. It has very much formalised our links between paediatrics and CAMHS, which has been very strengthening, and what we have done is formalised, we've been able to formalise in our individual job plans, one morning every 6 weeks to jointly discuss any patients that are co-managed, but equally any referrals going between the 2 services. We've recruited 2 new speciality doctors, and our triage process is so much more rigorous now that we are not having to send as many patients away to say, I need more information on you. That happens maybe 3 or 4 times a month out of a caseload of maybe about 70 or 80. So it's not happening anywhere near as often as it was. At this stage, I'm quite happy to take questions from anybody.
Thank you so much for this talk. In terms of PAs for consultants, because that's with job planning, that's obviously the conversation that will come up. How much does that amount to?
Well, as in my ADHD commitment, out of my
triaging commitment.
Right. It's we have to go to 1 morning every 7 weeks. Because there's a group of about 7 of us that provide services within the 1 building. Now, we are not all ADHD clinicians. Some of those will be neurodevelopmental. Mm-hmm. So there's currently 3 ADHD clinicians, or 2.5, within the building. So they will. The commitment is you cancel 1 clinic every 7 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
But the knock-on effect for that is so, so much more than that.
Just to dig a bit deeper into that, How did you, or how do you manage that in the face of increasing demand? Because if I went to my managers and said, listen, this sounds a great idea, look at these graphs, I've still got a backlog of patients that's ever increasing to be seen, that I'll take away clinical time to be seen and in to do triage. So how did you manage the transitionary period?
The managers actually bought into this very, very early on. Our nurse manager, who's quite senior in the hierarchy, was one of the drivers of this, because she is very much systems and process orientated, and she could see the rank inefficiency in kids being all over the place in clinics across three different sites, seeing different people, and often seeing different people for the same problem. So she was saying, we are giving out far, far too many appointments for the same thing. So with that clinical pathway, which is quite akin to what you were talking about, and the streamlined pathway, we were able then very early on to demonstrate a much greater efficiency, and therefore the management bought into this really, really easily then, because they were able to say your throughput is much more. Well, yes, in the sense that we had raised these issues, which management knew about, but what we were able to do then was to back up what we were saying with data, and equally then compare pre and post, and be able to say, yes, we were right about this, but equally you have bought into this and changed something alongside us, and therefore we're both right. And that's political language, and politics in Northern Ireland just go hand in hand. We have a separate coordinator for the autism pathway, but the children can flip-flop between the two internally without having to come out of one pathway and go and sit on the big waiting list for the other one. So there's an internal referral pathway between the autism pathway and the ADHD pathway. And there's a huge substantial overlap, and I think to have them as sort of parallel circuits would be utterly wrong. So they're very much integrated that way.
Is this mine? It's a question to both you and Susan about transitions to adult services. What challenges are you facing in your areas? I'm just asking, it's a selfish question.